So all the results are out and my car's turbo is broken and I got to Gran Canaria. Let's get to it. Yes, I'm talking to you from an Airbnb in Gran Canaria. Finally made it, finally guys. This is my dream and so many things that are gonna be happening here with PIRAS Motorsport and everything that I'm putting up with the in-person experiences, but I'll talk to that about that later on. And disclaimer. I made this engines killing video about LSPI, low speed pre-ignition, because I wanted you as usual to know and to have the facts. Myself, this is my disclaimer, I am super invested in the GR Yaris. In December, we're coming out with the airbox that we worked so hard to industrialize and to stamp in plastic to bring you the best product on the market for cheaper than anyone else. So this is just one. We're also doing the version for the Corolla. We've done the brake cooling kit. The hood vents are going great and all of that. So I am super invested. I have no reason to not to help Toyota. I even paid people to reach out to Toyota to tell them, hey, let's do a GR experience at the Canary Islands. But at the moment, nothing has come back from there. So it's not like in any way I want to damage the brand. It's just that information is what it is. So if there is a problem, there is. But I reading all the comments, and thank you very much for the huge success of this video. I saw that many still are not sure of how to act and what to do in order not to have this problem or to, let's say, diminish the possibilities of having their engine blowing up even from stock. So we can sum it up in 5 points, and being the first. Yes, whatever you are told by whoever, the 5W30 or even superior hot viscosity oil will help you, but it must be API-SP or, and ISLAC GF-6. ISLAC is the international standard for oils, and in 2020 this was updated exactly because of the LSPI. So they put some new solvents within the oil and additives that diminish the problem of pre-ignition in the ignition chamber, in fact. So this can help you very much indeed. Second thing, oil cooler. You want to ideally keep your oil as cool as possible. So ideally, once again, around 100 degrees under stress would be great. You can achieve this very simply installing an oil cooler, and you can get another 5 or 10 degrees with our own hood vents, but I'm not selling this once again to sell our product. You know me, I'm never pushing for anything, but this is what also Acme saw on our cars and our customers worldwide know that I've already installed them. Then, baffling your sump. Now I know Rogelli Racing is coming out with a new aluminium sump, but also Lamp Speed that I use has this baffle kit that is great. This has not a direct effect on helping this issue, but it has an effect in stabilizing the pressures of the oil within the system, eliminating starvation upon hard driving. And believe me, hard driving doesn't have to be only done on the track. If you go to a mountain road or a rally B road or whatever, and you're braking hard because you are in high grip conditions, that can already cause oil starving. You will not know if you have a stock ECU, but you are in this condition. And if you open your engine, you will see that there has been some starvation. Other thing, fourth point, fuel quality. The better fuel quality you will have, the better the engine will run and the less you will have problems of detonation. Once again, 100 octane, 98 if that is not available, but only always use this fuel. And also, it's the best and cheapest upgrade. You like to go fast? Yeah, you're gonna get more horsepower for real. 5 to 20 horsepower in real use, because the ECU will not be pulling the timing. And this makes a huge difference, especially in this small count cylinder engine like this one. Point five is driving style. I said this in the other video, but please do not make this engine work outside of the turbo's optimal window. So if you are in a high gear, just drop a gear like in all turbos and you will be in the optimal range to accelerate, and this will be fine. So I hope this is all clear. If it's not, we can still discuss in the comments, but anyway, I got this out of the way. I feel much better for it now. Now, on a negative, after all this dyno time, I get the car back and my wastegate is rattling. I wasn't sure if it was something in the exhaust, but we diagnosed it in the last days, running and everything. And actually I have a wastegate rattle. Apparently it's not something common on GR Yaris's. And yes, I am guilty of driving the car very hard, but apart from this, I took great care of the car. So now the car is on a container coming here to GC. So once it gets here, we're gonna strip it down, strip the turbo out and understand what happened. And I'm also gonna decide if I'm gonna build this engine on camera to show you guys how it's done and what the state is of the engine, but I'm still thinking about that and what to do. Other thing, I was not sure before knowing of this wastegate rattle if there actually were some problems with the exhaust. Because I was using, I did a lot of development with Inox car on the GR Yaris's exhausts, and we went through many versions. And in the end, we were working on an exhaust that would eliminate all drone. So you may recall from previous videos on exhausts that we used basically a mechanical silencer chamber, just like the stock one, but with a bigger, let's say, holes to make a more airflow in the same volume. I was not sure that this would have damaged a little bit our performance at the higher revs and the higher power with the 70 millimeter exhaust and this specific silencer. So what I did is, with no time whatsoever, I run to my friends at Inox Car and they very kindly in 24 hours built me another exhaust. And we installed, because I had a D-cat, a 200 cell cat, because we could not live with that, because the cats were not available when we did the line before. And that went in the position of the OPF. And we put a double exit exhaust with two pass-through mufflers that is also certified for European conformity. So you can get two with that and everything. So I then drove for 3.5 hours all the way back to Acme, that very kindly dynoed the car again, but not only, they also called the tuner to test the car again with the other exhaust. So the Ecotec master came and he did all his work and he said, I can't get any more of it. Basically, with this wastegate issue, what happens is he is using, let's say, to give you some numbers, 70% duty cycle to boost up and spool at 1.8 bar, and then he's tapering that down. And on other cars, without the turbo problem, he is doing the same thing at 35-37% of wastegate duty cycle. So this means that he was still achieving and holding the boost, so I think that the results are not that affected. But the turbo is obviously on its way out because of the wastegate itself, because we had inspected the turbine side at least and it looked perfect just a month ago. So I'm sure that the turbo itself is fine, but there is some problem with the wastegate. We will see once the car gets to me. So about the EZ cams, after I've done, having done all these tests, first exhaust, second exhaust, with the cat, without the cat, with the mapper trying it on always, I can tell you that the exhaust I posted 2 weeks ago are actually concrete and are good. And you can also see it if you see that it only has 6 degrees more of timing duration in regards to the new ones, and this is why the A-cams are so much better and give better performance. So I am very, very thankful to all of you for your support and the incredible numbers from the last video. And please support me more, because I'm really putting myself in your hands now with this move and everything, and I'm gonna bring you so much more and so much better. Ciao for now, and I'm gonna be back very soon.